All right, welcome back. We'll continue and we will get down to business now. And we'll do so by writing out the weak form, the weak form for linearized elasticity, right? So I'm going to take the approach we adopted when we worked with linear, elliptic PDEs with scalar variables in 3D, okay, which is that I'm going to first put down the weak form, and then I will demonstrate how we obtain it from the strong form. I won't go back the other way, to just because those arguments are identical to what we did in 1D, but they are, you know, they're more subtle and so on. Okay, but however, we know how they operate and they hold. Okay, weak form of linearized elasticity. And from here onward, I'm going to use coordinate notation only, okay? Because there are details, as you can see, which become most transparent when we use coordinate notation. Okay, so given the usual data, given UG sub I, T bar I, FI, the constitutive relation sigma ij equals cij kl epsilon kl, and the kinematic relation epsilon KL equals 1/2 partial of UK with respect to XL plus partial of UL with respect to XK. Okay, given all of this, find UI, okay, which belongs to some space S, okay, which consists of all UI such that UI equals the Dirichlet boundary data on the corresponding Dirichlet boundary reserved for that particular component, right? Of course, what's implied here is I equals 1, 2, 3, okay? Find UI belonging to S in this of this type, such that for all WI belonging to V, which now consists of all functions which satisfy the homogeneous boundary condition on the corresponding Dirichlet boundary, right? Here too we imply that I equals 1, 2, okay? Okay, so let me read this all over. Given the data U, T bar, UG, T bar, F, and the constitutive relation, and the kinematic relation, epsilon equals those derivatives of U, find u belonging to S such that for all w belonging to V, the following holds, right? All right, so now let's write out what holds. Integral over omega w I comma j sigma ij dv equals integral over omega w I f I dv plus, now here comes the rub, because of the fact that our traction boundary condition needs to be specified individually for each component, we need to straight away here have a sum I going from one to number of spatial dimensions, and of course we're doing this in three dimensions, right? Of integral over the corresponding traction boundary, okay, of w I t bar I d s. I want to emphasize here that do we imply a sum in that integrand over I? Think about it. Look at that last term. There is, in fact, no sum. Okay, a sum is not implied there. A sum is explicitly being carried out here. But importantly, we don't do that over the integrand because why do we not do it over the integrand? It's because that domain of integration could be different for each component I. Okay, so we can't quite do it as an implied sum. What we need to do instead is compute that product for each value of I, wi t bar I, integrate it over the corresponding Neumann boundary, right, which could be different for each component, right? We get a scalar, right? And then we sum up those scalars, right, over the three spatial dimensions, or over the spatial dimensions. Okay, so that's important to note. Okay, so let me state here, no sum implied for just that term, w I t bar I. Okay, instead we have that explicit sum. All right, this is our weak form. What I will do now is derive it from the strong form, okay? And I'm going to take a bit of a shortcut. I'm not going to maybe I will restate all the data very quickly. Okay, so I'm going to state here first that the strong form implies the weak form. And the weak form also implies the strong form, but like we did for the case of the scalar 3D elliptic linear equations, we'll do only the rightward implication here, right? The rightward equivalence, just as a demonstration. All right, and that is the following, right? Once again, given u g I t bar I f I, the constitutive relation sigma ij equals cijkl epsilon kl, the kinematic relation epsilon kl equals this okay. What we want to do is find UI such that sigma ij, comma j, plus fi equals 0 in omega, and boundary conditions ui equals ugi on the relevant Dirichlet boundary, and sigma ij nj equals t bar I on okay, so this is our strong form, right? Yet again. All right, we start out from here, and now we introduce, as we did before, the weighting function, right? So what we start off by saying is, now let us consider wi belonging to V, which has the usual property, right? Which is that V consists of all wi such that wi vanishes on that Dirichlet boundary. Okay? What we will do now, and this is something you may recall from our previous repeated developments of the weak form. Actually, think about it. What do? How do we proceed now? Right, we multiply that PDE with WI and integrate. Okay? So, what we do is multiply the PDE by WI and integrate. Over our domain omega, right? Which is an open domain in R3. All right, fine. When we do this, here's what we get. We get integral over omega wi sigma ij comma j dv plus integral over omega wi fi dv equals 0. Okay? Here, sums are implied over I. Okay, so I'm not going to state it, which means the sum is implied, right? Okay. So, do you recall what comes next? Right, we observe that this divergence, right, we get rid of by invoking integration by parts. Right, and integration by parts, you may recall, is nothing but a combination of the product rule of differentiation and Gauss's theorem of divergence, right, applied to tensors now. Okay, so what we do here is integrate by parts, right, and we integrate by parts on that term. Okay, and in integrating by parts, remember that this is basically product rule of differentiation plus the divergence theorem. Okay, and the way we do that is the following, right? We observe first that that derivative on sigma can be rewritten if we just consider it to be the following. Integral over omega, a derivative of the whole product okay, minus an integral over omega wi comma j sigma ij dv. And what I've done here is apply the first of my two techniques here, right? I've applied the product rule here. Okay? And of course, along for the ride is wifi dv integrated over omega, and the whole thing is equal to zero. Okay? The next step, we invoke the divergence theorem on the first integral. And in doing so, we observe that since the I index has been contracted out here, sum being implied, that term in parentheses is essentially a vector, right? A vector with free index j. And we recognize that we have properly here the divergence of that vector, right? That vector for our purposes is something that you may probably write as w dot sigma, okay? So we just have the divergence of that vector. Right, so now we apply the divergence theorem on that term. Right, and in doing so, what we get is integral over the boundary, okay, wi sigma ij nj ds minus, the other terms don't get, don't change, minus wi comma j sigma ij dv plus integral over omega wi fi dv equals zero. Okay, we have this, and what we're going to do now is two things. I'm going to rearrange things a little, and the way I'm going to rearrange this is by observing that this term has a negative sign, so I'm going to move it to the other side, but I'm going to change my left and right hand sides,